Trent dudes, what's happening, man? This is Trent, and you know, I get a lot of emails from students whose art teachers ask them to, hey, contact a professional and ask him a bunch of the same questions. And I get asked these same questions so many times that I thought, well, I'll just do one video. And that way I could just forward this to, you know, all your student buddies and anybody else who's a student whose teacher is too lazy to do their job. Just kidding. No, but I know this could be invaluable information. So now I do a lot of different jobs. I used to be a concept artist. I was a comic book artist before. Now I can only assume that what they're asking me about is how to be a content creator for YouTube. And now that's just one of my jobs, but I thought I'd go into it and explain a little bit of these questions, answer these questions from the perspective of being a content creator for YouTube. Okay, so question number one, describe the day-to-day tasks, functions, and or responsibilities of your profession. Basically, what does a typical day look like for you? Well, first things first, I run an art house, so like I take care of my business and emails and all the back and forth that I got to do with, you know, if I'm getting a sponsorship from Wacom or if I'm getting some kind of a sponsorship or product or something, I'm talking to people from XP Pen and they want to send me the latest thing. So I'll take care of all my emails first thing in the morning, you know. And yeah, that's usually for me, probably about 10 a.m. because I stay up late, and I'll get to that in a minute. But so emails, communications, I check with my Discord. I figure out like, what am I going to tweet about today? What artwork have I been working on recently? You know, that I want to share on Instagram. I share across all of my platforms. That takes a good chunk of my day, actually, a good chunk of the beginning of my day. And then let's say probably about like noon, I'll take a little bit of a breather. And by that point, I'm like kind of tired of dealing with meetings or anything that I got to do with that. anything that I got to take care of to make sure that the business part is done, that gets taken care of first. The next thing that I dig into is, of course, lunch. I keep it pretty short. My wife and I pretty much just go out to someplace local or we cook something at home. I've been trying to eat a little bit better, but man, I got that lockdown belly. Mm. I've been eating good and not getting enough exercise. So we do a little bit of just taking a little bit of a breather and take care of any shipments of mail because I have an eBay store. We sell a lot of the comics that I've worked on throughout the years or illustrated novels, signed editions and things like that. I got an eBay store. So like we got to ship all that stuff out. So that's been recently kind of a thing that we got to do. After we get back from lunch, I'll usually work on a video such as like, that's literally what I'm doing right now. We just got back from doing a little bit of a lunch break. And so like I'm working on a video, which is essentially, you know, I find a question that somebody from my community has asked and I try to address that and I try to pick something that more than just one or two people are going to be interested in. I try to think of things that many people are going through and I try to make a video based on that. And I probably spend the next few hours editing that, you know, and then usually what happens next is I get to finally get to draw by about 2 or 3 p.m. So I get to paint. Lately, it's been a little bit less because you spend a lot of time editing videos. People might not realize sometimes to make a 10-minute video, I'll spend like 5 or 6 hours just editing that. So I really do need to find an editor, I think. That would be very helpful. Okay, after that, pretty much I'm drawing until about 6 p.m. 6 p.m. I take my dinner break. After dinner, I walk the dog, and then we'll chill out and maybe watch some TV for a little bit or watch a movie because it's during lockdown. You can't really go and do a lot of things. I do play video games maybe almost every night for at least like 20 to 30 minutes, sometimes a couple hours. Lately, I've been playing Spider-Man, Miles Morales. Great game, by the way. I want to do a Trent's Game Room about that one. That keeps me up till about 2 a.m. A lot of times I'll be, if I'm not playing a game at that time, I'll be working on my comic or I'll be working on a script or giving feedback to one of my artists that I'm employing. So that's kind of, you know, when I'm doing my content creator kind of a day-to-day, that's my focus of my stuff. But that's actually only about 2 days a week. Most of my week is actually doing contract concept art or working on some of my illustrated novels or other projects. So question number two, what are some of the projects that you're currently working on? Well, right now I'm working on a how to draw comics workshop. I'm going to be doing a really in-depth breakdown as I'm reimagining Creed Reimaginary. That is basically going to be converted into a workshop as well so that people can learn how I put together a comic book from everything from start to finish, writing the story to like laying out pages from pencils to inks to colors, the digital process, the lettering, everything. So I'm working on that right now for my Gumroad channel. I'm also going to be working on a creature workshop for concept art for video games. So as you may or may not know, I did concept art for video games for many years. So I'm making a really in-depth creature design workshop that I've been putting together with one of my artists that I work with, Anton. Bachmat. You might be familiar with him. Tremendous artist. So he and I are putting that together. I'm working on some indie game stuff as well, which I can't really talk about. But that's what we're working on. And then, of course, I got my top secret NDA stuff that I'm working on for clients. Question number three, describe some of the pros and cons of being a content creator, a YouTuber. Well, some of the cons are that probably, like, it's hard to spend so much time editing videos. It's a lot of work. And then sometimes, you know, I don't exactly get the quickest cuts and like the fanciest video cut editing techniques and things. So actually, yeah, you know, like that's probably the thing that takes the most amount of time. And then coming up with the ideas for the videos isn't super difficult, but also I don't like to just make videos for the sake of making videos. Like I want to actually really help people. So, you know, sometimes picking the right question is like, you know, the biggest challenge. And then also thinking about like from everybody's perspective, like even this video, for instance, I had to really give a lot of thought to like, what are they asking about here, you know? And like, what are, you know, from coming from the perspective of a person who's still a student, I have to think about that. I'm thinking a lot about who's watching this. I'm trying to give you the best information I can. And also keep it very concise. It's hard to truncate everything down into like the most bite-sized statements, you know, and without, you know, because there's nuance. There's always nuance. And you don't always have time to make a 2-hour video explaining all the nuance. So that's the biggest challenge. The pros, I mean, I get to work from home. I get to work from wherever. You know, my wife and I will spend, you know, a few weeks in Thailand or, you know, working off of, you know, out of an island someplace. Like we travel a good amount when we're not during lockdown times. So like that's a really cool pro. You know, sometimes I get invited out to do talks at universities or at art schools or at other game development studios because of my history of working on popular video games. You know, I get free perks. I get like free Wacom tablets and free XP Pen tablets. And a lot of times if I want to reach out to a celebrity, depending on their fame level, I can usually get in touch with them. My buddy told me, you're never creepy if you have as many subscribers as you are. So that's kind of a pro. That's kind of a perk. You know, you get kind of like treated a little bit more special. Whereas like if you don't have any followers on social media, sometimes... Man, I still remember. It's like it's tough because like a lot of times people go, well, what's your social media presence? And it's almost like a scorecard. And so like, you know, there's a lot of perks to having a good amount of following. So, you know, I saw that coming maybe 10 years ago, which is why I started my YouTube channel a long time ago. Let's see, what's the next question? What are some of your early roles in the field? Well, as a YouTuber, I did this channel was originally an animated channel. I just did an animation for a show called Nova Colony Show. In fact, that's the original address of the channel. If you type in youtube.com Nova Colony Show, it takes you to the same channel. I had them change it to my name. But originally, that's what this channel was. And in fact, if I did not have my YouTube channel, I would not have met my wife. One of the first things I did back in 2010 or 2011 was I put a time lapse of basically doing what I do now, where I put my artwork up and I try to explain how I did it. Cause I thought, wow, there's so many people who don't know how to draw, or how we make art for games. So I'm going to start doing videos. So like 2011, I think, it was when I started posting, time-lapse of my artwork and, started posting some of my comic book stuff that I was doing and the process and all that. So my earliest videos are that kind of stuff, but I had some challenges. I'm a nervous wreck, a socially awkward fella. So it took a little while to build up my confidence to feel where I feel just comfortable talking on camera. And that was probably the biggest challenge with the early YouTube stuff. How that helped me to meet my wife was that when we first met, of course, when you first meet somebody, you don't know who they are, what they're about. Anyway, she watched some of my videos and decided that she liked my personality from the way I was speaking a little bit, and she thought that I was a very skilled artist. So, hey, you know, she's not an artist, but she appreciates the art. And so it was a way for me to, I realized it was a way for me to showcase a little bit of my personality in a visual, audio-visual sort of a way. And I was like, hey, this is way better than doing a blog or something. People can actually get to know me a little bit. So that's how that happened. Pretty cool. Next question. What would you say is the biggest turnoff for people who are trying to follow this line of work? Well, you could accidentally mess up and before you know it, you get canceled. And that's like very, very fun to go through because you have the wrong political stance or because you are a critical thinker or whatever it is, you know? And so like, you always have some dingleberry who's very jealous or just doesn't like that you've done some things with your art career. And so like, they want to tear you down. And so, like, it's not pleasant, you know, you read a bunch of nasty things about yourself that just aren't true. That's not very nice. And some people don't have the thick skin to do that. I found that I developed a thicker skin. I used to be very sensitive about these things. And I was like, I don't want anyone to not like me. Now, I don't care, man. I'll tell you straight up what I still try to keep it, like, you know, friendly. I don't want to intentionally go out looking for a way to, like, make people feel uncomfortable or unwelcome here. But I certainly, at the same time, don't shy away from expressing my true opinions, you know, if I'm faced with that. So, like, that's the difficult thing. And then also trying to be just considerate of everybody out there. So, like, if I'm talking about, you know, money, which is a big issue for artists, you know, I have to think about that from the perspective of when I was struggling with that too, and to try to be sensitive to the people who are still struggling with some of those things. Try to be considerate enough to not be rude. I'm just like, it's hard for me to not be rude. That's my challenge. The biggest turnoff for a lot of people is also the long period of time you have to give to it before you really get traction and people start to know who you are and care about what you have to say. So, like, you know, doing YouTube and being a content creator is the greatest job in the world. It really is. But man, is it hard to establish yourself. You're going to have to do it for a few years. Or there's always the temptation to take the shortcuts and just do controversial or, you know, or I guess you'd say offensive content. And that's the dark side. That's the dark side of the force, baby. And I try to, you know, not do that. You know, there's always a temptation to blow up your channel, but, like, I'm comfortable just being, like, a not super popular channel, but, like, popular enough. I got a lot of loyal followers, a lot of people who tune in every week just to hear me talk. Why? I don't know, but I'm grateful. And I would never want to betray their trust, and I want to keep delivering the best content I can do for you guys. Okay, so next question. Would you say that this career path lets you balance work and your social life? Doing as a content creator and as a YouTuber? Absolutely. As a concept artist working in games? Ooh, man, that was work-life balance. Maybe it's a little easier these days. It wasn't when I was doing it, not when I was working in a house. So I'm really glad to be independent and free. Basically own my own stuff. I don't get to own everything that I make. And, you know, man, it's awesome. And yeah, I work from home. So, like, I get to spend a lot of time with my wife, and I get to spend a lot of time playing with my dog and just, like, spending time with friends that I choose to spend time with. Like, very important, I think. Work-life balance, A-okay. Working as a social media celebrity, I don't want to say that, but as, like, somebody who's doing okay at it, yeah, it's great work-life balance. I also have stores set up, and so, like, you know, having my Gumroad channel, it's great. You wake up in the morning and you got a little bit of an extra paycheck there. You know, it's like, it's nice. That's the best kind of a business to have, is one where you own all of your own content and you've got enough people who support what you're doing. You're giving them value and they're giving you value. Like, they're giving you all the support that you need. It's just, man, it's awesome. Love it. I feel so blessed. Honestly, I'm so grateful. Every day, I thank God for the opportunities that I have to be a content creator on YouTube. So, question number seven, who are some of your inspirations? So I started making YouTube videos because of, originally, it was probably Ego Raptor doing the Metal Gear Awesome animations. And that's why I started doing YouTube videos, was because I really liked the idea of doing these animations, animated shows done with, like, you know, super budget, with, like, just simple animation tools. As an artist on YouTube, there weren't any. There was nobody else. There was, I think Feng Zhu had done a couple of videos at that point, but for the most part, the first videos that I saw of artists doing time-lapse videos were the old Todd McFarlane VHS tapes of him and Rob Liefeld and Jim Lee making time-lapse videos and explaining the tools that pro comic book artists at the time were using. And that was super enlightening. And I was like, I want to do that. That's what I want. And then, of course, at my workplace, they just kept asking if they could see time lapses of my paintings. So I started recording time lapses of my old World of Warcraft concept art when I was working at Blizzard. And then, so I still have some of that, and some of it made it onto the DVDs, the behind the scenes DVDs. So, like, those, my earliest inspirations for doing YouTube were probably that. And then later, just for, in terms of, like, tone, I was really inspired by Kyle Bossman, who was part of the Game Trailer squad at the time. He was just a very genuine, honest, funny guy. And he was socially awkward, but like that inspired me to just kind of go, you know what, I think I can break out of my shell a little bit. If this weirdo, no, I'm just kidding. I have so much respect for that guy. But like if he could just be himself and be comfortable in front of a camera, then maybe I could too. And so like I thought, well, all right, let's just do it. Let's just do it. And it was hard to get over that hurdle. I used to be a nervous wreck. Okay, last question. What other resources or people would you suggest that someone starting off in this career path should check out? Man, I don't know, because YouTube is very crowded right now. I would actually recommend that maybe you check out new platforms. There's other video services. Maybe like try a different angle, you know, try to find a way to bring your art to different platforms. There's new social media platforms popping up a lot right now, which is good competition. For the big guys, good competition for Twitter, good competition for YouTube, good competition for all the major players in the social media space, for influencers and whatnot. Just as a content creator, I'd say just content is king. Like find a platform that's still budding and developing and blowing up fast and post a lot of content that people get engagement with and build your momentum as quickly as possible. When I started out, the first 2 years were really tough. I spent 2 years with not a lot of views, and it took a while before people really gravitated to like figure out like, oh man, you know, this channel is pretty hype. So it took me a while to figure out how to make the best kind of content, and hopefully I'm delivering that, you know. Hopefully this is the only resource you need. I actually do a lot of videos about Instagram, about YouTube, about how to edit videos and things like that. There are also other resources, so I would say that you really just got to make a list of things that you want to learn how to do in terms of like making a better social media presence. Learning how to create content more efficiently and effectively. You learn some video editing tools and just start doing it. Get your feet wet. You might fail for a while, but if you learn to love the process, you'll stick with it. And then eventually you get good at it. And then before you know it, people are encouraging you on and they're telling you what they want. And that's the best thing right there. So bam, that's how I did it. That's how you can do it too. So that should answer all of your student questions. If you had any more questions about how to be an artist, a pro artist, or I guess you'd call me an influencer, but I don't like that term because it implies that I'm just telling you what to think. But if you want to learn more about being an artist on YouTube and Instagram and Twitter and all that, please drop those questions in the comments below. I also answer a lot of questions about art technique and concept art for video games, which I do still work on. And I have another video about that and the day of the life of a concept artist over on my Gumroad channel as well. So dudes, that about wraps it up for me this video. And until next time, I'll catch y'all mañana, Debon. And if you don't know what that means every Wednesday and sometimes more. So I'll catch you in the next video. All right, ciao, baby. Oh yeah.